Now, this idea of instantaneous rate of change at a single value, that is what the derivative of a function at a point is. So if we let f be a nice continuous function on an open interval, and we let c be some value in that interval, the derivative of f at c, which is always denoted by f prime of c, there's some other notations that we'll see later. F prime of c is equal to instantaneous rate of change. So the instantaneous rate of change is the derivative at the value of c. Again, we have to allow h's to be positive and negative values. Now, there are certain functions where this limit would not exist, but as long as that limit exists, then that's the derivative. And if we can find a derivative, we say the function is differentiable at c. So having a derivative at c is the same thing as being differentiable at c. Now, in terms of what I was saying just a moment ago, if we let f be that continuous function and we let f be differentiable at c, then the line that I was drawing through the point c, f, with slope being the instantaneous rate of change, or the slope being the derivative, is called the tangent line to the graph at the value of c. In my previous problem, I could have put the point of interest anywhere. Let's put it over here at negative 2.5, I guess. So what would the tangent line be at x equals negative 2.5? Well, it wouldn't be this blue line that I have drawn now, because this is not giving me the instantaneous rate of change. It's going to be the blue line, or at least something really close to the blue line there. Notice that what's happening here is this blue line is coming down. It's basically touching that point, and then it's off the curve again. So the blue line is touching that point, and then it's off the curve again. I can't get it to line up. But so the tangent line is this one. I always think about the tangent line as being a line where what direction you're moving in. So let's say we want to be on this point here, and we want a tangent line. Imagine this other point being a car driving along a road which is curved like this one. Well, if the car is driving along the road, the curve like this one, and it gets to this point, at that point, the headlights of the car are going to be pointing in the tangent line direction. So think of our car moving along the road. Where the headlights are pointing is in the tangent line direction. So the tangent line is the line through this point and in the direction of the way the curve is moving at that certain value. And it's a limit of things called secant lines. Secant lines are lines where we have two points on our curve. So secant lines are lines whose slope is an average rate of change. And if we take the limit of that as h gets closer and closer to zero, then we get that instantaneous rate of change. Let's do example three. Example three asks us to find the derivative of the tangent line, the derivative and the tangent line for this function at x equals negative 2. So we've already found the instantaneous rate of change at x equals 1. So we've already found the derivative at x equals 1. Let's find the derivative at x equals negative 2, which is the instantaneous rate of change at x equals negative 2. Our function is the same function, x squared plus 3x minus 2. And we're looking at the instantaneous rate of change at x equals negative 2. Since we know something now, since we know that the instantaneous rate of the function is the derivative of the function, we can say that's the derivative of f at x equals negative 2. The notation, by the way, is once again f prime of negative 2. And so we put in limit as h goes to 0, f of negative 2 plus h minus f of negative 2. So we plug in negative 2 plus h into our function f, and then we're going to start doing a lot of algebraic manipulation. So negative 2 plus h quantity squared plus 3 times the quantity negative 2 plus h minus 2. That's what I got when I plugged it into f. When I plug in negative 2 into f, I get negative 2 squared plus 3 times negative 2 minus 2. Let's multiply out this negative 2 plus h squared. You're going to end up with 4 plus, 4 minus 4h plus h squared. When you multiply 3 times negative 2 plus h, you end up with a minus 6 plus 3h. And you still have a minus 2 there. When we plug in negative 2 into our function, we get negative 2 squared plus 3 times negative 2 minus 2. That gives you a value of negative 4. Now I can start combining like terms. I will start with the h squared minus 1h, 4 minus 6 minus 2 is minus 4. And then subtracting a negative 4 is just like adding a 4. So one more step, that minus 4 and this plus 4 will cancel each other out. Again, all I'm doing is simplifying that top fraction, the numerator, the top of the fraction. And once you simplify it as much as you can, you get down to a place where your numerator is h squared minus 1h and your denominator is h. Now, if you were to plug in the 0 right there, you'd get 0 over 0. We'd get an indeterminate form. So we can't just plug in h right there because of that indeterminate form. But we know that algebraically, if a function and another function are equal in all but one spot, then their limits are going to be equal. So I can simply algebraically divide by h to end up with h minus 1. And now I can plug in the value of 0 into the expression h minus 1. and I end up with 0 minus 1, which is negative 1. So the instantaneous rate of change is negative 1, which if we were writing this as a function, we'd say f prime of negative 2 is equal to negative 1. And everyone would know in mathematics that that meant the derivative of f at the value of negative 2 is equal to negative 1. This is how we write the derivative. Obviously, right now, it's taking us a little bit of time and effort to go from the difference quotient and simplify that thing down till we get a real number. But that's the way we have to do things for now. Later on, we'll see some shortcuts where we don't have to do all of that. Okay, so that is the derivative. Let's say we want the tangent line. Well, a tangent line is just a line. Y equals slope times X plus B. And on a tangent line, the slope is derivative. So what that means is, in this case, if I want the tangent line at negative 2, I want a slope of negative 1. So the slope is going to be negative 1 because the slope is the derivative at that point. Now, what point are we talking about? Well, we're talking about what happens when you plug in negative 2 into the function. And remember, if you just plug in negative 2 into the function, we saw earlier that when you plugged in negative 2 into a function, you get negative 4. You can also do that manually right now. Just plug in negative 2 into my original function. And we get out a negative 4. So that means my tangent line has slope of negative 1 and goes through the point negative 2, negative 4. So if I know the tangent line has slope of 1, I can take y equals mx plus b, and I know the m will be negative 1. If I know it goes through the point 2, negative 4, then what I can do is I can replace the y value with a negative 4 and an x value with negative 2. And that creates an equation which I can solve for b. If you do that, you'll quickly see that b has to be negative 6. And so the tangent line is the equation y equals negative 1 times x minus 6. Slope negative 1 through the y-intercept of 0, negative 6. Let's look at that graphically to confirm that that all makes sense. So what I've done is I've graphed the function and I've highlighted the point negative 2, negative 4. And then let's just take and graph y equals negative 1x minus 6. And sure enough, you can see that that line hits the point negative 2, negative 4 and is traveling in the same direction as that line is moving at that point. So this is my tangent line. And again, if you think about a car on that point driving along a road, the tangent line is kind of showing you where the headlights would be pointing. I would like you to do the same thing with this function here. It's going to take a little bit of work because we have an x cubed. So cubing a polynomial is going to take place. So it's going to be a little bit of work, but I think you can do this one. Find the derivative of g of x equals x to the third minus 5x squared.